Thanks, Chair, for the very kind introduction. And I would like to also thank the organizing committee for giving me the opportunity to share some of our recent discoveries in this wonderful meeting. And today I want to address the issue that what's the role of ABCG2 in the stem cell and also possibly in the so-called cancer stem cell. It's a rather the basic issue. I think it probably not fit very well to today's main focus, but we think it may be involved in maintaining the genetic stability of the embryonic stem cell. So it might have some implication for if we want to translate the embryonic stem cell to the clinical. I think some audience may know that I'm the person working on the mechanism to control the cell phase switch. So actually I was impressed by the embryonic stem cell has the pluripotency to differentiate into the cell of the switch germ layer. So originally we want to use the embryonic stem cell as model to study how cell can differentiate into the three germ layer. For example, we have a reproduced size protocol showing that if we culture the embryonic stem cell and the PS6 feeder, they will be able to largely become the nesting positive neuron precursor cell. However, just like early embryogenesis, if we moderate in the concentration of BMP, then some of them will convert to become the epidermal lineage. And also we are also trying to test how the embryonic stem cell can also become either the mesoderm or endoderm. And basically my lab is mainly focused on how embryonic stem cell can differentiate into the endoderm. But during the work done, we are also quite interested to know when the embryonic stem cell maintain on the fibroblast feeder, how the genetic integrity can be maintained on those feeders. And actually in the 80s, people know that either the mitomycin treat fibroblast feeder or irradiation treat feeder all produce a high level of RAS, reactive oxygen species. So actually we are concerned in such a cultural condition whether the DNA damage in the embryonic stem cell will occur. In fact, DNA damage are normally occur during the normal cell proliferation. Mainly is because that reactive oxygen species will be generated by the mitochondrial respiration. And actually, in fact, that people have compared that the rate of spontaneous mutation in ESL is quite relatively lower than the somatic cell. So therefore, people believe, scientists believe that the ESL may propose the specific mechanism in order to maintain their genetic stability. In fact, in 2004, Lin's lab has found that P53 can actually bind to the promoter of nano after the DNA damage. Then will result in the suppression of nano expression. And when the rapid downregulation of the nano will push the ESL to differentiate. The consequence is that for those DNA damaged ESL differentiate, then you'll be able to eliminate those DNA damaged ESL from the self-renewal pore of the ESL. Then the maintained remaining ES will still without the or has a very less DNA damage. And also not only that, the recent work by the Lakers group from the Newcastle University, they also demonstrate that the ESL actually maintain the low level of ROS because they have a higher level expression of antioxidant enzyme. That resulting they can reduce the oxygen. They also have the low mitochondrial biogenesis. In combining these two mechanisms, that's the reason they can maintain they have a lower level of ROS. So the result indicate that although ESL can proliferate very fastly, but they might have a certain mechanism in order to maintain the balance of the energy requirement, oxygen consumption, or even to preventing the DNA mutation during their self-renewal expansion. We are quite interested to see whether there's any common gene that regulate those stem cell behavior. And a few years ago, a few scientists actually proposed that the stem cell, the embryonic stem cell or tissue stem cell, they may have a co-set of a stemness gene, the common stemness gene. Although many groups have tried put the effort to see whether they can use a functional genomic method to find the overlap in common gene. But however, most of the work is showing that there's not very consistent result. And also, but people still believe that although the individual stem cell may express a certain set of the individual lineage-specific stem cell gene, but they also probably share some common standard gene, and the specific combination of a common and the lineage-specific gene may lead to the stem cell self-renewal and differentiation. So a few years ago, we started looking for, is there any really common stem cell gene exists? So when I look for the literature, we found there's a gene called ABCG2, actually it's widely expressed in a wide variety of stem cells. And also people have found it's actually it's a molecular determinant of a so-called site population. In fact, in Maggie's group, they actually in early 90s, they found that the ability of hematopoietic stem cell to efflux host time, which can generate the so-called site population cell in the fast analysis, is quite a good approach to isolate the hematopoietic stem cell. And follow up, actually, many of other groups also showed that the same phenomena can be utilized to enrich either bone marrow stem cell, brain neural stem cell, skeletal muscle cell, even the liver stem cell. So that's it to say, maybe NH2 actually is a compound expressed in the adult tissue stem cell. And also, when we also searched for the standards, the database also found that not only the adult tissue stem cell expresses ABCG2, but also the human embryonic stem cell also expresses ABCG2. So we try to confirm that actually in the both mouse embryonic stem cell or human embryonic stem cell line, we culture will find actually they all express the ABCG2. So we are curious wondering whether the ABCG2 is really a common so-called standard gene. And recent Red's work very interesting show that people in trying to find a way can identify the real IPS clone during the IPS reprogramming. And from the Georgie Day's group of work recently shows that there's at least three types of cloning will form during the IPS reprogramming. There's one type so-called the type 1. Type 1, they don't have the retrovirus silencing, so they can express the GLP, but they also only have very low levels as it's a EA4. And second part is they both express the GLP, indicating they don't have retrovirus silencing, but they also start to express SSEA4. And third part is actually they have a GLP silencing, but they express SSEA4. The interesting thing they found that for those type 3 clone, they have very thin, the Hodgkin's type very thin clone. And then after they done a serious gene analysis, they found both type 1 and type 2 actually are either the incomplete reprogram clone or at an intermediate stage of reprogramming. In contrast, for those type 3, they have HERS, EFAS, and TVD clone, they are truly the IPS clone, indicating even the induced, the fully reprogram induced human pluripotent stem cell line, actually they have a phenotype that's expressed the ABCG2, they have the HERS-style EFAS activity. So that really indicating the ABCG2 may play a role in those pluripotent stem cells. So what's the ABC transporter ABCG2? Actually, it's a very large class. It contains the ATP binding cassette. It's a transporter. So by hydrolyzing the ATG, they can have energy to pump a wide variety of substrates, including some metabolic product, including the anti-cancer drug, including some toxin or even some lipid or steroids. For example, in this family, there are a few quite famous molecules, for example, the MDR1 or even the MRP3, both are well-known as a multi-drug resistant transporter. Another famous member is the molecule I mentioned today, is ABCG2. It was firstly known as so-called BCRP1 because it was isolated from the breast cancer resistant cell. So it was the original name as breast cancer resistant protein. It also has a multi-drug resistant ability. For example, it can efflux the doxorubicin and some topoisomerase inhibitor. In fact, people have found that ABCG2 is a half transporter, so it means two molecules to form a complete transporter. So in the N-terminal, there's an ATP binding domain. So when the ATP binds, they can hydrolyze the ATP, they have energy to efflux the substrate. And the scientists have studied the ABCG2 for age, and they found that the wide variety of substrate can be efflux by this transporter. For example, the anti-cancer drug, the porphyrin, and even the some fluorescence dye, like I mentioned, the Hurst dye, or even the rhodamine 123. So the key part is whether it's really important for either cell differentiation or even for the development. Just a Poland group published a paper in 2006. They show that, in fact, in the early embryo during the mouse development, from the aurora stage or in the for the blastocyst stage, there are some so-called cell has the efflux activity. So you can see some rhodamine 123 standing thin cell start to appear in the molar stage or even in the inner cell mass. And by examining for those cells, they found they either express the ABCG2 or ABCB1, indicating they really involved in the early embryo development. So we start to analyze whether ABCG2 is expressed in the undifferentiated ESL, it can express in the early differentiation of the embryo body. So we start to analyze a few members, including ABCA1, ABCB2, ABCB, CB1, and ABCC3. We found most of them actually expressed in the ESL. And in fact, the ABCG2 also expressed in the early embryo body formation. And we not only use one line, we start to scanning whether all the embryonic stem cell line express ABCG2, so we find the four different mouse embryonic stem cell line to start with. We found all four lines express ABCG2. So we initially find if we inhibit the ABCG2 transporter, how is it going to happen? So we use a selective and potent inhibitor FTC to treat those embryonic stem cell during the culture. Initially, we found that although the colony can still grow, but when the cell going to the day two or day three, we start to find the level of the nano expression was significantly downregulated, as judged by also by the real-time RT-PCR. And also we found for those cells has lower level of the nano expression, found they start to express some differentiating markers such as nesting, indicating they probably caused the spontaneous differentiation because of a downregulation of nano. So we have to confirm that whether the result was coming from the suppression of ABCG2 function. So we also performed the knockdown of ABCG2 by shRNA, and we show that in fact for those GFP mark shRNA transfect the embryonic stem cell, it showed relatively lower level of nanoc. And also by doing the real-time PCR, also confirmed the result that by applying for the shABCG2 RNA, they can also accompanied by the downregulation of an analog, indicating the suppression of ABCG2 may affect the expression level of an analog, and in fact also probably affect the prepotency, as judged by we carry out the chimera assay by using those ABCG2 knockdown ESL and inject into the blastocyst. We show actually we've done this twice. No chimeric device can be formed by using those knockdown ESL, indicating their prophylaxis was affected by ABCG2 knockdown. So we're next trying to address what's the consequence, what's really the phenotype affected by the inhibition of ABCG2. So we start to do a time treatment experiment by using the FTC in compare with normal culture ESL. We're showing that after treat for 3 days, the nano expression was completely done. And also we also obtained that actually at that stage, the growth of the expansion of ESL was also be suppressed. And then also we found the cell cycle profiling was also affected by the inhibition of ABCG2. And also the embryo body differentiation status was also affected by the ABCG2 inhibition, indicating although it's a transporter, but the inhibition of this function indeed affect part of the embryonic stem cell phenotype. Then we're trying to look for what's the actual physiological role of the ABCG2. Because for those molecule, people are all well known that the anti, it's a it can efflux anti-cancer drug, so it's involved immediate multi-drug resistance. But we believe that those proteins are not bound for the efflux anti-cancer drug. So we want to look for what is the actual physiological role in the cell. So we try to look for the literature and find out, actually start from the year 12 to people have started making the ABCG2 knockout mice. The knockout mice basically is fertilized, and their lifespan, body weight, basically is quite normal. However, people find that it seems very sensitive for the protoporphyrin degradation product, indicating it might affect the protoporphyrin homeostasis maintenance. Also, people also find that for those MCU knockout in poisoned progenitor cells, they have the impaired survival in the hypoxic condition, indicating because they might involve the affecting the protoporphyrin homeostasis, indicating the probably that also affect the gene synthesis. So the, for the oxygen utilization might also affect by its division in ABCG2. In fact, people find that using the in vitro culture model, they found that the expression level of ABCG2 is induced in the hypoxic condition. And also, in the in vitro data, people also show that ABCG2 can directly interact with either heme or porphyrin, suggesting that both molecules are probably the substrate of ABCG2. In fact, in the cell, the porphyrin homeostasis was tightly regulated by different kinds of transporter. For example, people show that STP1 is involved in mediating the transportation of the porphyrin from the outside the cell into the cell. And also the ABCD6 is located in the mitochondrial membrane. It can transport the porphyrin from the cytoplasmic region to the mitochondria. And the result from in vitro study indicating that the porphyrin also probably located in the membrane of the cell. They can evade the efflux of porphyrin from the inside the cell to the outside the cell. So we start to analyze whether ABCG2 expression was altered during the ESL expansion by doing the RT-PCR. Initially, we found that, to our surprise, that during the 6-day cutoff embryonic stem cell, we found the level of ABCG2 which was increased, accompanied by the protoporphyrin efflux the content reduced, indicating when the cell growing, so they need to maintain the porphyrin in the low level in the cell. So I'm wondering whether during the embryonic stem cell expansion, probably they need to increase the oxygen usage or the sum of cells are maintaining in the hypoxic condition. That's the reason they need to regulate the porphyrin synthesis. And in fact, we want to compare prove the hypoxic that we basically use a brief hypoxia treatment for the mouse embryonic stem cell. We found indeed it increased the cellular level of protoporphyrin, accompanied by the increased level of the ROS, indicating they increased the porphyrin synthesis, accompanied by increased the mitochondrial saturation and produce more ROS. So we then tried to set up an assay to direct proof that it indeed is directly involved in the regulation of cellular level of porphyrin. So we try to treat the cell with the porphyrin precursor delta LA because it was the main precursor for synthesis of the porphyrin. So increased substrate will enhance the porphyrin synthesis pathway, and then they can produce more heme containing protein. And followed by, for using this, it will followed by interfering with either to modulate the ABCG2 expression or to downregulate the ABCG2 expression or even the suppression of the function of ABCG2 to prove that ABCG2 is directly involved in regulating the porphyrin homeostasis. So by this figure, we show that by suppression of ABCG2 function, we show the level of the porphyrin fluorescence was increased after treat for FTC. In contrast, if we addition of the delta ALA, we show the increase of porphyrin fluorescence as well. And what do notice that if we treat embryonic stem cell with the delta ALA, it actually affects the nano expression. In some carnage, also we show that only the small carnage can form, indicating the excess level of PPX may probably affect, already sufficient to affect the ESL, the maintenance. And next, we try to address whether the specificity of ABCG2 involved in this process, either by overexpression of ABCG2 or downregulation of ABCG2, to show that whether the porphyrin level or porphyrinolysis was affected. In way, we see that if we overexpress ABCG2, the porphyrin fluorescence level was significantly reduced. In contrast, if we downregulate ABCG2, then the porphyrin fluorescence level will increase. And furthermore, if we add delta delta ALA together with inhibitor or overexpressed ABCG2 or downregulate ABCG2, all indicating that ABCG2 directly involved in porphyrin efflux. Then, what's the context of the level increase, porphyrin level increase in the cell? So we continue to check. If we treat the cell with FTC in order to inhibit ABCG2 function, so the porphyrin level increase accompanied by also we found that ROS level will increase together with some anti-ROS enzyme expression level was decreased, indicating probably in that condition, actually cell was encountered for higher level of ROS in the cell. Then we predict that that might be affect the DNA damage in the DNA repairing pathway. Indeed, we find that even the treated inhibitor for 2 days or even the 4 days, there is a significant increase of gamma H2AX, indicating the cell already accumulate the sufficient amount of double-strand DNA break. And then the increase of gamma H2AX accompanied by the activation of the increased level of PP3 and also the phosphorylation of PP3, indicating the DNA repairing pathway was activated. And then in that activation of PP3, also the consequence is also involved in the downregulation of NANOG. Then the consequence we know when the NANOG downregulate, the cell probably can either arrest and or even the differentiation. So in order to prove that PP3 was the main mediator to involve in the downregulation of NANOG in this pathway, so we create a conditional P3 knockdown embryonic cell by using the P-cycle construct. The construct is that they have a U6 promoter followed by a LAX CME GLP LAX cassette and the SHP3 construct. So when we add the Cre protein, they will exercise the LAX construct, then start to activate to express SHP3. Therefore, we can at a certain point we can knock down P3 to see whether P3 knockdown is the main pathway to mediate the nano downregulation in ESL. And shown right here, originally the cell will express the GLP. So when we add the Cre protein, so the GLP will eliminate and the cell start to express the P3 shRNA. So by using this method, so we can show that yes, we create the clone as the construct based on muscle clone instead of GLP, indicating they have the construct inside the embryonic stem cell. So we add the Cre protein, we show the P3 was knocked down together with the GLP was shut off. And also for those cells, that doesn't affect the nano expression. And in contrast, if we add the FTC, the nano expression was downregulated. But in contrast, if we under the FTC treat condition, we add the Cre protein in order to knock down P3, we see for those GLP negative cells, they still maintain higher level of nano. Indicating for those FTC inhibitors result in the nano downregulation that mainly mediated by the expression of P3 or activation of P3. Actually, also recently also we try to move confirm whether the similar behavior was seen in the human embryo cell. And human embryo cell actually we found a very interesting phenomenon when we grow the human embryo cell and mouse embryonic feeder, it express the relative higher level of ABCG2. But when we move to the feeder-free condition, the level of ABCG2 was downregulated. It also has the porphyrin synthesis ability and also the porphyrin efflux ability. The same result, actually, similar result was obtained by another group, Sakani. The group also recently showed that when they grow the H9 and the mouse embryonic feeder, they have a higher level of the ABCG2. But however, if they grow under metagel, the level of ABCG2 will be reduced, indicating probably H3 expression was one of the response to the cultural environment. So in summary, for this part of work, we reveal a certain role of ABCG2 in the embryonic stem cell, that the inhibition of ABCG2 probably will lead accumulation of porphyrins, which in turn probably increase the level always either by the fountain reaction of excess protoporphyrin. And also the increase of ROS, the consequence of the increase of ROS will cause the DNA damage, indicated by the increase of gamma H2AX and also by the activation of P53 pathway. And the inhibition of ABCG2 resulting in the phosphorylation of P53 then leads to the downregulation of NALOG. So actually we maybe show the evidence showing that ABCG2 probably plays a protective role in preventing the accumulation of PBX during the colony expansion, and also the probably also play a role to do the colony control for the ES. So the reason is that if they detect the DNA damage in the ES cell, they can activate the P53 pathway, then result in the downregulation of NALOG. So the, for those can self-renew ES cell, will be removed if they have the DNA damage. For those cells, doesn't affect by DNA damage, they can continue in the self-renewal pool. Then, whether the pathway was also involved in the cancer stem cell was also one of the important issues we are trying to address. So I want to use probably 5-10 minutes also to address whether ABCG2 also play a role in the so-called cancer stem cell. In fact, in the early 90s, people, scientists believed that there's only a small subset of cancer cell known as the cancer stem cell, which can sustain the ability to self-renew and also to initiate the tumor. As in the classical stochastic model, people show that most tumors are heterogeneous, indicating they probably need derived from the multiple clone. However, in the reality, people found only a subset of the cell can initiate the tumor growth. That's the reason, that's the lead, the so-called cancer stem cell hypothesis. In fact, the experimental evidence proves that there is a cancer stem cell exists, start from the 1997 John Dick's group, showing that the leukemia cell has a stem cell potential. And start from the year 2003, there's a few group basically showing that the cancer stem cell not only exists in the liquid tumor, but also exists in the solid tumor. And in fact, using the name as the cancer stem cell, people may concern that it's a cancer derived from the cancer. In fact, people try to define the name as cancer cell because it was defined from the experimental result. It means a subset of tumor has the capacity to self-renew, and they can generate a heterogeneous tumor. For those subset tumor, we can call it cancer stem cell. But basically, it's not means it all the cancer was derived from the so-called stem cell. Probably we can also name as a cancer cell with some stem cell property. But what's the proposed future for the cancer stem cell, and what's the importance for us to target, to study the cancer stem cell? One thing is, basically, they can enrich for those certain populations, they have a higher tumorigenic ability. They probably have a good differentiation potential. That's the reason they can generate a heterogeneous tumor phenotype. And also because they can they have a self-renewal capacity, that's the reason they can remain in the tissue mass. But the most important reason to target in the cancer stem cell is it probably mediate the drug resistance or be involved in the cancer relapse. So we are considering whether the ABCG2, which is expression of ABCG2 in the cancer cell, was the reason they have a multi drug resistance. And also whether ABCG2 are in fact involved in regulating the self renewal of the cancer stem cell. In fact, existing data suggesting that ABCG2 is playing a very important role in maintaining the stem cell phenotype and also the cancer cell multi drug resistance. and recent work published in the International Journal of Cancer. They actually using the MCF7 MX cell and also lung cancer cell, A549 cell. They show that if they inhibit of ABCG2 by SHI was actually sufficient to inhibit the proliferation of this cell, indicating the self-renewal of certain subpopulation of cancer indeed probably was also regulated by the ABCG2 downstream pathway. So we started working on whether the MCF cancer cell has a very similar ability as the ESL2. So basically we have analyzed the MCF7 breast cancer cell that contain probably one-fourth of the ABCG2 pathway, and they have the ability to synthesize the porphyrin and also to efflux the porphyrin. So we try to study whether the inhibition of the ABCG2 will cause the increase of porphyrin accumulation in the cell. So by the same FTC and other flavone-derived inhibitor. Basically, either those inhibitors all show that the FTC or other inhibitor treatment can also cause to increase the intracellular level of the porphyrin. And then the consequence is that we find that, you know, the breast cancer stem cell, one of the important duties, they can form the manosphere, indicating they have a self-renewal capacity. And when we treat the FTC or other potent ABCG2 inhibitor, that seems to affect the manosphere formation. And the consequences are also what the characteristic of those ABCG2 positive cells. So we try to isolate those so-called breast cancer stem cells from this MCF7 cell line by using the marker of the CD34 negative low or CD44 positive, together with to analyze those ABCG2 positive population and ABCG2 negative population. So we isolate those cells and start to grow. We found that for those ABCG2 positive cells, they have the ability to differentiate into either ABCG2 positive population or ABCG2 negative population. But for those negative cells, they don't have the loss differentiation capacity. They only can maintain in the ABCG2 negative status. Moreover, we also find that when you suppress the ABCG2 with inhibitor FTC, it also affect the cell cycle of the ABCG2 positive population, indicating for those ABCG2 positive, the cancer stem in shaving cell was actually probably need ABCG2 to maintain its self-renewal. Furthermore, we also find that if we inhibition of ABCG2 positive relation by inhibitor, it also causes a reduction of ABCG2 negative cell, indicating those ABCG2 cells are actually, during the normal culture, are derived from the ABCG2 positive cell, as shown by here. We see only after FTC was sufficient to reduce the number of ABCG2 negative cells, indicating even in the heterogeneous cancer cell, they also grow like the cascade. So for those downstream ABCG2 negative cells are probably differentiated from the ABCG2 positive cancer stem cell. So in summary, although we haven't complete the mechanism to rule out whether the MCF7 follows the same mechanism as the embryonic stem cell too. But indeed, we find that for those ABCG2 positive CD24 low or negative CD44 positive breast cancer stem cell, they display the differential potential and the ability to efflux the PPIX. Inhibition of ABCG2 not only affect the cell cycle of the positive population, formation of manosphere was probably also sufficient to reduce the ABCG2 negative population. So I want to acknowledge the main contributor to this work. Now, basically, from the first part of work done in the embryonic stem cell was done by my postdoc, Dr. Jimmy Sutanto, and my student, Chen Yongnan. And also for those studying the role of the ABCG2 in the cancer stem cell was achieved by my PhD student, Liao Wenyi. And also we are also working on the pancreatic cancer stem cell model to see that only the phenotype not only exists in breast cancer stem cell, but probably also the pancreatic cancer stem cell. And the one part of work I did not show that actually the ABCG2 also play a role in the pancreatic transdivision or pancreatic cell phase switch. And then we are underway to create the ABCG2 CRE-ER model as well as the ABCG2 knockout model to see whether the in vivo during the cancer formation is played a very important role. And I also want to thank my collaborator, our director, Dr. Chen Zhouxuan, who helped us to set up the proteomic analysis on those issue not on ESL. That reason we can find out what's the main pathway mediated by the ABCG2 inhibition. Also, I would like to thank Dr. Huang Xiaomin who helped us to start to establish some human embryonic stem cell model in order to prove whether those concepts are also can apply on the human embryonic stem cell culture. And I'd like to thank Dr. Liao Zhizhong provide some wide variety of ABCG2 inhibitor to see whether he can targeting for those cancers stem cell study. And also Dr. Li Zhong to help us to do the fast sorting. And some key regions like PCO construct provided by MIT Dr. Tyler Jack. And we're also on the way to study what mechanisms involved in regulating the function of ABCG2. For example, whether the PI3K was involved, so we are involving using the P10 NACA mice. And thank you for the submit project for the support. And I thank you for your listening. Thank you.